folks, I'm Janek Gwizdala. It's the Janek Gwizdala podcast from his days with Aldi Meola, Billy Cobham, the Brecker brothers, vital information in the studio scene in New York, to moving out west and becoming a staple in the bass department of the Los Angeles studio scene, playing with people like Tracy Chapman and John Tesh and Chick Corea and Frank Gambale, and the list goes on and on and on. This intro alone could be an hour if I attempted to do Tim Land as one of my all-time bass heroes justice in terms of the intro, but I'll let the interview speak for itself. This is something I have immense pleasure in being able to present to you. I literally met Tim 5 minutes before we hit record. It was such a long time coming. I'm sure it's the first of many meetings, the first of many interviews. There was so much more to talk about. But without any further ado, this is my interview with the immense Tim Landers.
What was that tune you were playing in the last podcast that Bob Reynolds? I played that with him. I played that with him on the, it was a Dean Brown gig that he did.
No kidding. You guys did that tune?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
That. It's a great tune.
Oh, man. It's Common Ground.
Common Ground, yeah.
Yeah.
Which is funny because there's a Stern tune called Common Ground.
That Mike and Randy used to play all the time on.
It's a beautiful ballad.
Oh, I love that. Yeah, the Randy solo on that is amazing.
Oh, man, I love Randy.
Okay, you want to pull that up a little closer? It's on a long arm, so you can relax and get
like
it in
this.
Place.
Is that cool like that?
Great.
Closer?
It sounds really good. Yeah, okay, you can eat these mics. You know, it's like the SM7B. So the prep on this interview, I could have done another 3 months. It's insane.
Okay.
And I hate having the, I'm just double checking, I'm always... Yeah, that we're running here. Okay. I hate having the phone out, but I have to because it's so freaking deep. I know we're not even going to get to a third of it.
Oh, none of it's real.
But since we started, like right there talking about Mike and Randy, there's a Barry Finity record I've got to look at the name now, and it is called New York City from 1982.
Oh, yeah, we recorded that at... Electric Ladyland.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay, so this is great. Wow, I'm so into getting into the weeds of that because it's Randy and Mike and Barry Rogers, who is credited as like not playing trombone on it or something. It's really weird credits. Yeah. Was that so casual back then to just show up and it was those three guys on a date? To me,
that's a great question.
To me as a fan, it's so special. Mm. I'm of that generation that looked only up and not sideways at those kind of musicians. Mm. Mike was the reason I moved to America, period.
I hear you. Yeah.
But for you, it's like you're walking into a date and it's those three guys and it's one of the most classic New York horn sections in history.
You know, Mike and Randy Brecker were probably the most easygoing people in their own way.
Yeah.
Randy is very salty character anyway. He's just got
that
sense of humor.
Yeah.
But as a guy is like just a, you know, a hang, super chill.
Yeah.
And Mike even more so. Mike was really quiet.
Yeah.
You know? And so like the first time I ever played with him, I can't remember I played with both of them. It was a gig, I think in Boston.
Okay.
That they were hired to play, you know, horns on, and I just happened to be playing with this person.
This is pre-moving to New York.
Wow. And so I met them then. And I was like you, like just such a huge fan. I'd gone to see the Breckers with Steve, by the way, Smith, and Vinnie. And we went to the Paul's Mall or Jazz Workshop, whatever, to see the Breckers. You know, it was with Will and...
like 81 or 82
Yeah, it was early, around the back-to-back days. So, you know, huge fan. And then seen them with Billy Cobham before that.
As Dreams or the Billy Cobham?
No, the Billy Cobham, like the first, you know, iteration.
Yeah.
Which was also amazing. I mean, that's a whole hour right there. All those bands that we went to see and watching like Vinnie Colaiuta and Steve Smith, like little kids, like just screaming at them, you know, at every fill that Billy played, you know, anyway. So I'd met them and then, and played with them a little bit and they were so cool that when I did do work with them, I wasn't so, you know, kind of intimidated, I guess would be the best word. Because as far as musicianship goes, you know, if you think about it, you'd be too scared to play it out.
I mean, Randy's 78 now. Yeah. Still, so I've been playing with him for 20 years on and off, and just how he sounds as a trumpet player at that age is insane.
He's amazing. Like, I did some gigs with Cobham about a year and a half ago. So like a tour, did a tour that Randy was on.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so we toured the States with Billy, with Randy on a bus.
Wow.
Yeah. And with Fareed Hawk on guitar and Scott Tibbs, I think, was the piano player on that one. It could have been. Yeah, but Randy, every night, it was just killer.
Incredible.
And Billy was throwing some stuff at us. His new tunes are just plain hard.
Also, this was new material as well. That's
a lot of new material. Well, he calls it the Crosswinds Project, so we kind of play like 3 or 4 or 5 tunes from the Crosswinds record, and then the rest of it is all his new stuff, which are these like suites.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, with all these like 5 movements and...
You know. I heard he's not a big fan of repeat marks, likes to write all the music
All linear, you know, it's like... through composer. So, I mean, thank God for iPads, right? And like the switching devices, but... And like, anyway, that's a whole other story too. But Randy was on that at tour, and every night it was just, I would be playing and just listening to what he's playing and going, oh my God, I can't believe I'm on stage with this guy. Yeah. You know, he's just such a legend and so great. And yeah.
I mean, that's nice to hear that it's still like that all of these years later, over 40 years later.
Yeah, I mean.
Talking about 40 years later, I have had the same gig 40 years apart now.
That's amazing.
I'm playing with Steve, and you played in the original iteration of Vital Information.
I knew, because that's a record you guys did about a year or so ago.
Yeah, Time Flies.
Time Flies, yeah. Which has that tune in like 6 or something.
Yeah.
It was a really cool
ba-da,
tune.
Ba-da, ba-da, ba-da. Yeah, okay, yeah.
Whose tune is that?
A lot of the tunes are Manuel's, the piano players. Yeah, you wrote a lot of stuff on there. All right, cool. There are some covers.
Yeah, you sound great on that, by the way. Oh, you really, and you got to check that out. What am I looking at?
Huh? Oh, just us. Cool. This is all casual.
Yeah, that record is, I was really, because I hadn't heard a lot of the newer stuff that Steve's doing.
Right.
Not purposely, it just hadn't.
Sure.
And so when I got to check what's going on, and I knew about that record, but I hadn't really listened to it, so I checked it out. Yeah, really great. But back, you know, back when we started, I don't know how much you know about the origins.
Well, he told me to ask you about practicing in a basement somewhere, or in his basement, or my mom's basement, your mom's basement,
or his shed,
right,
or his dad's shed.
Yeah,
I mean, there's a lot of stories. Some I can't tell,
and you know, and that he was friends with Neal Steubenhouse.
Yes,
introduced you as a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
He told me that.
There's a classic story that goes with that. Real quick on that Barry record, by the Barry Finnerty record.
Yeah,
and he had a lot of people on it. Anthony's on it.
Yes,
you know, and I think Gad's on it.
Tons of
people. There's a lot of people on it, you know, and you know, Barry just called me because we had done a gig with Billy, you know, and he just said, man, I want you to play my record. And it was like one of these things that came down, and he had everything, you know, Barry charted everything out, and it was a pretty straight ahead session, you know, just reading it down and playing it a few times, and then that was it. And I'd kind of forgotten about it. It came out, you know, about a year later. But at the session itself, I was more enamored with the studio because I'd never been in Electric Ladyland before.
Oh, okay.
And I remember kind of walking through that studio, and it's like these weird little tunnels, and it's all kind of very mysterious and dark and ugly, you know.
And you obviously knew about it.
Being a big Hendrix fan growing up. So, so that was that session was like that, what I remember of it.
And back in the day, like, it's interesting you talk about there being so many different people on there. There are a ton of records that I pulled up. Lee Ritenour, there's one where there's you and Marcus and Patitucci and.
Yeah.
I think Nathan East, there's like 5 or 6 of you on there.
Yeah.
That's a little later, that's in the 90s.
Yeah.
But when you go back to the 80s, what was the whole thing around, like, you had to put a whole session together, a whole band, and go into a place like Electric Ladyland with an all-star cast to cut 1 track, 2 tracks.
Yeah.
Like, that's kind of unheard of.
Well, there used to be this thing called a record budget.
You know? I've read about
it. Yeah, you know, record companies actually would sign you, you know, and give you some money to do a record. Wow. That was incredible. You think
insane.
About it. I know. But truly, that's part of it. You know?
Right.
And then, you know, in order to be able to sell a couple of copies, you had to call some favors, you know.
Gotcha.
And that's really what it was.
So even with the budget, people were still like, hey, can you like
snip? You know,
we got some
Barry
time at 2 a.m.
Barry had played on, you know, the Breckers, you know, Heavy Metal Bebop.
Yeah.
And, you know, they just, we were buddies and friends. Yeah. There was a pretty tight community in New York.
I mean, it's interesting. Like, I lived there for a decade before I came out here.
So, you know.
Obviously. Yeah. Well, but I'd never experienced that. I mean, were you around when Radio Registry
was a thing? Yeah, just towards the end of that. And I didn't really get involved in that. Radio Registry, by the way, was a place where, I mean, it was a system.
Service, yeah.
Service for, like, you know, getting calls for dates.
Right.
Yeah. Well, they had a similar thing out here in L.A. called Your Girl.
Okay.
Yeah. I think it was Your Girl or My Girl. Your Girl.
Okay.
Yeah. Which was a guy named Tiger who sounded like a woman. But,
okay.
As a matter of fact, I thought he was a woman for the first couple of years I used it. But that was the same thing.
Okay.
You know, if you were getting called to do dates, you know, they would call you.
Yeah.
You know, hey, it's, you know, Santa Crescent wants you on a movie date for, it's at, you know, CBS Radford, 8:30 start. You know, 2 days,
whatever.
Can you make it?
Yeah.
That's always the end of, can you make it?
Right.
Yes, I can make that. And then, it's up for Upright and Electric or whatever, you know.
Right.
And then that's how they did it.
Now, New York always struck me, even
when I was
there.
The radio was the same thing.
Right. Now, New York always struck me, even when I was there, like I moved in 2000 and stayed there for a decade, that it was quite a, like you said, a tight-knit thing. But it sort of felt like more like an immediate meritocracy.
Yeah.
Than like having to sort of smooth, you're like, you could play, you are in, to a certain extent. It seemed like LA, not that I ever did what I did in New York and LA, I chose to be like, I just live here, I don't work here. But it always seemed like, oh, it takes a little more time and you got to be in more of a scene and maybe a clique and have some real serious ins.
Yeah.
Rather than just being the guy or girl at a club
who
plays some hot shit and suddenly produces a kind of calling you, right?
That's really good observation, because in New York, they were more apt to, like, you know, grab onto the newest gun in town.
Right.
You know, and use them on the whatever.
I had a few months of that. Like, I experienced that. Like,
I mean, because there's that excitability, you know.
Right.
But then again, there was the structured part, too. Like, especially, like, the jingles scene there.
Right. I did, like, maybe four jingles in the entire time.
And same here. I could not, you know, my way into that.
Okay.
There were a handful of people who did everything.
Wow.
You know, from Gordon Edwards to Will Lee, you know, and
of
between.
Course.
And Marcus was working his way up too.
Right.
You know, he was like, Marcus was pretty young when I moved to New York. He was probably 18.
So he's younger than you?
He's younger than me by a couple of years.
Okay.
Yeah. And so, he was called the young Marcus Miller back then. You know, young Marcus, you know.
Okay.
You know, from Jamaica, Queens. Yep. I think he's like Wynton Kelly's nephew or something, you know.
Okay.
But he was like, you know, already killing it.
Right.
I mean, musically.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, just forget about it. And so he started working his way into the scene. But Will was doing a lot of stuff,
right.
Will Lee. And it was Charlie Drayton's dad, I think, was one of the contractors that did most of the stuff. And so, like, you know, there was like, there was a family that did a lot of the work. There was the John Tropeas and the Steve Kahns and like that.
Were you around Hiram Bullock at all?
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I actually did a couple of Mike Brecker's gigs for Marcus. And that's how I met a couple people that would like, that Marcus couldn't do, and they were at 7th Avenue South.
I was going to ask you if you were around for the 7th Avenue South.
It was like his quintet.
Wow.
And so.
Who was in the band?
It was like Kenny Kirkland and like, it was a killer. And I think Barry actually played guitar on one.
Okay.
Yeah. And maybe it was Brian Brake or somebody like that. And then Billy Cobham came in. That's how I met Billy.
Oh.
Was he subbed for somebody for one of Mike's gigs? And no, I take that back. I met Billy on a Gil Evans orchestra gig.
Okay.
But they were tied together.
Yeah.
But anyway, back to the jingle thing and the scene, it was like, you know, it was hard to get into that studio scene. And one of the reasons why I came to the West Coast was I started coming out here. Occasionally I would get, like, Vinnie Colaiuta, who we were really close back then, he would get me on record dates out here.
Like band dates.
Yeah, and I would get him on record dates in New York.
Gotcha.
So he would come to the city, stay at my apartment,
right.
We'd, you know, go work at a studio across town, whatever, stay for a week, you know, hang, get in trouble. And then, I mean, good trouble.
Yeah.
And then, you know, and the same thing, he'd like throw me a bone this way, you know, he got me on, I remember he got me on a Gino Vanelli record.
Oh.
And, which is another story, but,
great.
But anyway, they flew me out here, you know, he picked me up at the airport with his Austin Healey 3000.
It
didn't have a second gear. Yeah. No, you had to kind of power shift it in the third.
Into third? Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, I was going to say, not just going everywhere in first.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
I guess anyway, so I'm going off in tangents.
That's okay.
But yeah, so I came, when I started coming out to do dates like that, and I'd come out to LA and, you know, I lived in an apartment on the Midtown East Side. It was okay.
Gotcha,
you know?
Yeah. I lived on Upper West Side, but small.
But, you know, it had like, you know, gates on the windows and like four, you know, locks on the door to get in. And, you know, it's kind of dingy, you know, and I'd come to L.A. and Vinnie's house, and he's got a pool and, a garage and, a nice car and a place to park it. Like, nice. Just think about, like, trying to find a parking space in New York, right? Forget about it. So I'm thinking, like, what the heck am I doing, man?
Right.
I should just, and every time I come out to L.A., somebody, hey, Tim, you should come out here. I mean, you do great, you know, kind of thing. So I finally decided to take the plunge, you know, moved out here.
How long
stayed at Vinnie's for the first, you know.
How long was the transition? Do you reckon?
Well, I started working pretty quickly.
Oh, great.
Yeah. But back to what we were talking about, the tight-knit thing in New York, I soon found out that there was a different scene altogether out here. There was a lot more loyalty.
Okay.
Yeah. So there were people that were doing a lot of dates, and I thought, you know, not that I had a big ego, but I thought, well, I'm going to come out there. I'm going to kill it. I mean, I've just been playing with this and the Breckers and Billy and Demiola, you know. Yeah. I can play anything, and I've got a rock background, so, you know.
Sure.
But I found out, no, it's a little more methodical here. You know, you kind of like, if you work your way into the session scene and you're good and you're consistent and, you know, you'll keep working. They don't just throw you, you know, off to the side just because there's a new guy in town.
Right.
So, and I also found out that there was a reason why some of these people were working that at first I thought, well, they're good, but, you know, I don't get it.
Yeah,
you know?
Sure.
There was a whole thing about their technique and their approach to playing, you know, songs and how they came up with parts and everything. I got a new appreciation for that.
I imagine was super different from New York, right?
Super different.
New York was like, bam, 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 bam.
Yeah, you know, New York, you'd like, walk into a studio on the 8th floor or someplace on 30-something street, and
you're not bringing a racket.
You don't bring anything. you're lucky if you can bring your bass, you know? Like, you know, just use that P bass that we've had here for 50 years, you know?
It's got the same
string. But no, you know, like, you just plug in direct, you know? Oh, my God, and the headphones they give you.
Gosh.
The bass player's always got the last direct box, the last headphones, the last music stand. Like, you couldn't even, like, you put music on, the thing would fall over, you know?
Never heard any bass in those things.
No, you know, the mixes were horrendous. Yeah. I mean, you couldn't complain.
Right.
You know? Because it's like, you know,
and like, so studios had gear back then. They have a B-15 and a mic or something that was pretty standard, or an SVT
in New York.
In New York,
every studio had a drum set,
right?
You know, a couple of drum sets, some, you know, twin,
yeah,
maybe, you know, a B-15 or a B-18 or, you know, some kind of bass amp, or maybe a bassman or something,
mic'd or direct or
mostly direct. But you could, if you asked for it, you know, if it was a record date, you could probably go through an amp.
Yeah,
if it was a jingle date, no.
Yeah.
And so, but, you know, you really were at the mercy of the engineers for your sound.
Right.
And
right.
Sometimes it was just hideous, you know. And you'd walk out of the session going, oh, man, I hope it sounds good.
So two questions come out of that. Did you ever feel like, okay, like that, like, oh, man, that's out there now forever, and that's really not me?
Yeah.
But then did you ever feel like you left the session feeling that and then heard the mix and was like, oh, actually, pretty cool?
Yeah. Like, sometimes, you know, you'd get
saved.
Well, most of the time I would say it would be okay, because like, you know, fundamentally what you're playing,
I mean, I've been listening nonstop to you. By the way, I should tell everyone who's listening and watching, I put together a Tim Landers, like, the entire history Spotify playlist.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, you're kidding.
Hundreds of songs on there. I'll link it in the description below the video.
Oh,
if you're watching on YouTube, it's epic.
That's insane.
It's so great. I've been listening to it in the car before I go to bed at night, just like really digging into it. And it's amazing. Like, there's nothing on there that I think, oh, that's weird. Like, how did you arrive at that? It all sounds like, but what's amazing is it sounds like eras of almost the technological development eras. Like, you listen back to that early Cobham stuff or that Barry Finity thing, and it's like, oh, that is 1982.
Yeah.
And then you hear this Lee Ritenour thing, and it's this super lush thing that sounds like there was a preamp and a compressor, and you took some time getting bass sounds.
Well, here's the thing. Now, when I came to LA, like I was saying, you could show up at the date with some gear.
Right.
Right, right. So that was the one of the main differences between New York sessions and LA sessions is you could bring gear to the LA dates. Right. Matter of fact, you could bring a rack. As a matter of fact, you could have a cartage guy. You could have a guy that would set up your gear. So
if you got Anthony survive in New York? He was always the gear guy.
Yeah, I mean, he, you know, he just, well, first of all, he's Anthony, right?
That's a really good
point. So he can, like, you know, if he wants it and it, you know what's going to get what you want, you just let him do his thing.
Yeah.
You know, I've asked so many people. As a matter of fact, I've lent him gear, mm-hmm. and when I got it back, I would, like, tape the settings, you know? So, like, so I wouldn't, you know? But anyway, you out here in LA, you could have a guy to come and set up your gear. And if you were busy enough and you had like a date like in North Hollywood and another one in Santa Monica, something like that, you'd have two sets of gear, right? And it would be set up ready. So you just walk in, it's all ready to go. Yeah. Just have your gig bags, you know? Yeah.
Amazing.
But over the years, I started accumulating stuff that would kind of help me mold my sound a little bit so I could give the engineer something that was closer to what I wanted to hear.
Now, is it an Ibanez fretless you were playing with Colin? Like in 78 with Gil Goldstein and Dean, right? Yeah. That was the quartet.
Yeah.
It's a great video on YouTube, live concert, and maybe there's a live album of that as well.
Yeah, I think so.
Is that what the live album is? So I was interested about that. Is that active or passive?
That was active.
That was, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, it was kind of like the Alfonso Johnson bass. You know? They had given me one before that was half fretless. Dig this.
Which half?
That's up above the 12th fret.
Oh, that's half it. That way. That's not it. Half
yeah, they figured you can only the fretless is only good up there.
Okay.
So, but anyway. That's what that be. I didn't use that for very long. It was because I had this thing going with Mike Padula. You know,
right?
That it just started.
When did you get involved, like in the design of, or did you get involved in the design of the preamp thing? Were you into that kind of nerdier side of?
I did on the PV line of basses that I did the TL5 and TL6.
Oh, I am not aware. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I had a line, you know, that was pretty successful for PV in the late '80s, early '90s.
Okay.
So I was really hands on with that as far as like. Not just the physical, you know,
like choosing frequencies in them.
For the preamp. But with Mike Padula, the basses that I worked on with him, those were all Bartolini stuff. So
I've got a fretless related question, and I have to reference which album it's from, because it was something I had in my head about Mick Kahn from Japan.
Oh, yeah.
And I wondered if you'd ever crossed paths or had listened to that ahead of time.
Yeah, I loved that.
The song is, I know it's Indian something. Oh, I should have organized these notes so much better. I can't believe I don't have it in there now. It's so nice, and it's like, oh, here we go, Phantom Center, track 4, Indian Dreams.
For Farron.
Farron.
The Canadian singer. Oh, I love that record.
Oh, that was such a good sound.
Creative record.
Yes.
You know?
And there you are, right out front.
Yeah, they would mix that fretless way up there.
Way in the front.
Yeah, I know. If I had known, I would have played something else. But no.
That really leapt out at me as I was listening to you.
Yeah, like, you know, those sessions are, I have a fond memory of those sessions.
Yeah.
They think they were Joe Ciccarelli or Chubba or somebody was one of the great engineers on it. So, and they
were— Here in LA.
Yeah, here in LA. It was probably done at Capitol and— Maybe at Sunset. No, it was Westlake.
Okay.
Westlake C, I think. And I mean, I remember like Denny Fonghiser being the drummer on, and he would like play like on a like a trap case or something, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, some kind of creative thing like that.
Nice.
And she's like this folker, you know, from Canada, like really great songs. And she was totally cool with letting us just, you know, be really experimental and creative with it. And I'd say, hey, I got this idea, you know. And of course, I still had Pino Palladino in my head, you know.
The Paul Young stuff.
Yeah, all the Paul Young stuff and like such great parts he came up with.
Sure.
I mean, to this day, I'm still amazed by those incredible parts. And not just the parts itself, but how he played.
Right.
Anyway, he's a genius. I don't want to talk about it. He's insane.
So, was he out here much? back
then? Yeah. Well, yeah, because then, you know, once that Paul Young stuff came out, everybody wanted him, oh, right? Yeah. And then, like, he was on the, what's his name from the Eagles?
Don Henley.
Don Henley.
Yeah.
Stuff, you know, yeah. Sunset Grill, is it?
Yeah.
All that, yeah. Just beautiful, gorgeous, fretless stuff that he played. And, yeah. But anyway, so that's like, you know, that was my thinking on that Farron record, was like, I'm just going to go for it. And they were like, yeah, cool.
And they went for it.
Yeah.
And like, when you were working with, in a situation like that, a band or artist record, where it's, I guess, the same people on the whole date, right?
Yes.
There wasn't a bunch of people switching in and out.
Mostly, yeah.
What was typical in terms of, hey, it's going to be 5 days, it's going to be 2 weeks, we're here for a month, it's only three. Like, what was typical for something like
that? Yeah. Good question, because this is, again, the days of the record budget. So they call, and, you know, the artist would get a producer, and it, you know, the record company would suggest, you know, maybe you should look at this person or that person. And then producers had people, you know, and they're stable, you know.
Right.
Yeah. And, you know, and they had pairings for drummers and bass players.
Gotcha, yeah.
You know, that they worked with, that they liked how they, not just how they played with each other, but sonically.
Sure.
How they fit.
I mean, Lee Sklar and Russ Conklin, all those kind of classic pairings.
Exactly. That's where that comes from, yeah. So, they would call you and say, you know, blah, 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 Joe Ciccarelli, he wants to use you in this record date. It's a Steve Wynn project. It's 5 days. It's a 5 day session.
Yeah.
It's, you know, they'll pay you $7,000 or whatever it is, you know, do you want to do it? I'm like, of course you want to do it. Maybe you might negotiate a little bit, but.
Sure.
But yeah, record dates were the thing. That's what you wanted to do.
Right, but typically 5 days, maybe a week.
Typically five days, try to do a whole record. And then always you'd come back, you know, they'd recut something.
Gotcha.
Or, you know, or maybe they want you to fix something or something. I mean, some things would go on forever. There was a David and David project. I remember this is classic.
Okay.
That these two guys, David Berwald and David, I forgot the other David, who later went on to write all the Sheryl Crow stuff.
Gotcha.
But they were new then. They were great. They had done this incredible demo, and this was going to be a huge record.
Yeah.
And they had cut the record, and I think Lee was on it. Sklar,
okay. Yeah.
Was on it. I'm pretty sure Lee Sklar was on it. And then I got a call from the producer and say, well, they want to replace the bass parts. I'm like, okay. And sometimes you go into a date and you'd hear that and you go, well, I like what I'm hearing.
Right.
I mean, you don't say it too loud, but you might say, hey, you know, I don't understand. Why do they want to replace this? Uh-huh. It sounds great to me.
Yeah.
I don't know. They just want to do it. Okay, fine. So I spent, you know, 3 or 4 days just overdubbing and replacing everything that Lee had played, I think. Pretty sure it was Lee.
Okay.
And then I left, you know, thinking, okay, well, that's weird, but, you know. So, and then a couple of weeks later, I run into somebody, I go, oh, you know, or Lee, or so, oh, you know, hey, they brought Lee back in to replace what I had done. Yeah. Is that you or me?
I think that might have been you, but it's all good.
Hold on. This is a thing called spam.
Yeah.
You know?
Or it might be a gig.
No, yeah. Oh, it's Lee. He's going, no, you're all wrong. That wasn't me. You'd never replace me, buddy. But what happened was I just went and redid what he had done that I had done. You know what I mean? It just went like that. And then when the record finally came out,
nobody knew who was on it.
David, the guy who'd played on the demo, the original guy who wrote the songs, just went back and played everything you'd played on the demo. I mean, it was a good record, but they had such demo-itis.
Right.
You know, that they just...
That's something I saw with Nashville demos. Like, my introduction to how good a demo could be was when I got asked to play, like, it was maybe 10, 15 years ago on a record. A demo, sorry, not a record.
Yeah.
It sounded like a record.
Yeah.
And I'm standing in the studio going, what are we doing here?
Yeah.
This sounds like a hit record.
Those
I know they knocked this out in one take in 30 minutes. How can we do better?
You can't top those Nashville guys.
It's crazy.
No, they're good. They're really good. And they're like...
They do like 5-8 tracks a day, you know. Like,
and they don't get paid enough.
True, yeah.
But so like that record, that David and David record went on and on and on. So, you know, you got paid a lot of money.
Sure.
For like...
Just keep coming back.
You never know. There was another record I did where I got called, one of the first records I did in L.A., and it was at Soundcastle, and like Dan Huff was on it, and... you know, it was Pasqua.
Alan, oh yeah.
And the first day of the day, and I had negotiated like, you know, triple scale.
Nice.
Yeah, I was like, so I'm like, you know, this is what I was told. I was always given this advice.
But okay.
By the way, Neal Steubenhaus was a huge mentor of mine. So okay. He's like, yeah, to me, you know, if you can get it, man, go for it. Like, okay. So I'm at this date, and like, so they're getting a snare sound, I think from Myron Grombacher, who's like Pat Benatar's guy.
Yeah.
He's like, and it's like, it's one of those that just working on different snares. And
for a day.
And like the drum doctor was the Cardis guy. And he's like, you know, he brought, you know, 14 snares, and they wanted to hear all of them. And so we're out there playing basketball and pool, getting paid triple scale.
Great.
For like 2 days.
Nice.
Yeah. And I'm thinking like, yeah, I like it out here. This is awesome. I haven't played a note.
Wow.
Yeah. So
when you talk about the loyalty thing, did that branch over into being able to leave for a tour and then come back and still get dates?
Great question. Because that was those days, it would be like where there's the road dogs,
right,
and there's the session guys. Uh-huh. And if you left town, you always took the risk of losing an account,
mm-hmm,
you know, and no matter who you are, you know, it's like the second person on the list, if they're available, they get the date. And then the contractors, you know, they just default to that person because they know they're available.
Right.
The contractors don't want to keep making calls.
Sure.
Doesn't matter who you are. So yeah, you'd have to, when you come back, you'd have to work your way back.
How big was the pool of contractors? We're talking like 15, 20 or
probably
like
something
five.
Like that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
And then, you know, different contractors for movies, for
right,
jingles,
exactly,
for bands.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There, you know, there was like Sandy DeCrescent was the one you wanted.
Right.
She was the,
I heard about her.
She was like the famous don't get on her bad side contractor.
Right.
You know.
Play good, show up on time.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah. Punctuality is key. Yeah. And, you know, be able to play in first take, you know,
yeah,
like that kind of thing. Like, you can't do a date with a 60-piece orchestra and blow a cue, you
no.
know.
No.
Yeah.
So that's amazing because, so reading was really a thing.
Super important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, unless you're doing movies, I think it's non-existent now. Like for me, as I consider myself a working bass player.
I would say feature film dates are probably the most important thing for reading.
Right.
And then everything under that.
And
you know,
doubling, I would imagine.
And
right?
Doubling, yeah. Yeah. And then jingles a little bit, but not, mm-hmm, you know, you'd have to read some. But you didn't really, it wasn't so much note reading. A lot
right.
of times jingles were basically sound-alikes of, you know, some pop tune or rock tune.
How was the, like, the award show scene out here? I'm imagining that's something very different, that none of that happened in New York.
Also a good reading thing. That's like movie dates, you know, because it would be, like, abbreviated cues from all these movies.
Right.
Right.
And dozens of them. Like
and
one
dozens of, yeah. And then you never know what you're going to play. It depends on who won.
Yeah.
You know, so
I watched Tim Pierce's YouTube channel. He's always doing some big thing where he's playing 200 songs in
it's,
an evening.
It's, I only did a few of those, maybe about a half a dozen or so, but I liked them.
Yeah.
See, I enjoyed the challenge of walking into a date not knowing what was going to be in front of me.
I love that.
Yeah.
That's my favorite.
It's killer,
thing,
right? Yeah. I mean, it's something of the adrenaline there.
Yeah. And when you're done, you're like, yeah.
It's not about arrogance. It's just confidence.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know.
And to me, it's like knowing you can still do it.
Yeah.
Because those muscles atrophy after a while, especially the way the scene is now.
It's you really have to keep it going.
Yeah.
Like, a good point. Like, we were talking about Bob Reynolds, one of Bob Reynolds' tunes.
Yeah.
And I remember I went to a rehearsal for a Dean Brown gig, and Bob was on the gig, and he brought two tunes.
Yeah.
One of them. And like, you know, and I'm like, I'm still a good reader, but I'm not the reader I was.
40,
I mean, I've got stories about like reading, you know, with the veritable fly shit and toilet paper stuff.
Right.
But you know, but yeah, and I'm like looking at that, and I'm like, I'm counting this thing out. I'm like, I keep screwing it up. Like, what am I doing wrong? You know, and I just realized I wasn't putting. I forgot what it was. I think it was that tune.
Common ground.
Because
dump biddy da 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 biddy da but it's that one always catches people.
Yeah, it's a little twisted.
And there's a unison bass line with
that
the piano.
One, yeah.
Right,
the way it's displaced.
Yes.
And I kept screwing it up, and I kept getting mad at myself. Like, I mean, what are you doing? You can read this, man. You know what I mean? Like,
I produced that record almost 20 years ago.
Oh, you did?
And I'm not immune to fucking it up on the gig.
Oh, okay. Well, phew, I don't feel so bad now. Because I did. You know, like Bob was kind of gone. You know?
No. What was the other tune he bought? Do you remember?
Oh, shoot.
No?
Don't remember. He had two.
I could
look it up.
No,
speaking of, I want to say that, you know, it's sad, but the Dean is gone. Really, and he was a very, very good friend of mine. And
Nick, yeah, I mean, you know, all the way back from then in Billy's band, 78. I mean,
gazillion stories. Well, we go back to Berkeley days.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
You were in school
and
together?
I got him on Vinyl Information.
Okay. He's so it was you, Dean, Steve.
Yeah.
And two guitars with Frank at some point?
So the original iteration of Vital was Dave Wilczewski.
Wilczewski, yeah, exactly. And
Steve and myself.
Yeah.
And then whoever guitar player we can get a hold of. We used to play around.
Stone, right?
We used to play around the Boston area. Right. Just, we actually called ourselves Not Bad for White Boys. That was his. Yeah.
Okay.
Which I kind of thought was funny. And then when Steve finally got us a record deal on Columbia, he had to change the name and he came up with Vital. Vital, you know.
Yeah.
Which at first I'm like, no one's going to remember that, man. You know?
40 years later.
Yeah, we'd go, we'd play gigs. Are you guys Vital Transformation? Like, yeah.
Wow. Okay.
But anyway, that's how it started.
Gotcha.
And then, we had like Michael Thompson played with us.
Yeah.
A guy named Jeff Ciampa, another guy named, Daryl Sturmer from Genesis.
And, okay, yeah.
He was played with us because Steve played with Daryl with John Luke.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So it was this kind of thing. On the three of us, Dave and Steve and myself, would get home from our tours, whatever.
Yeah.
We'd get together like we used to do in the old days in the shed and stuff and just play. And we'd play at like Jackson Cambridge or Pooh's Pub or one of these clubs.
Sure.
And then get a guitar player to play with us. And we'd just pick a bunch of tunes. And Wilczewski had tunes that he was writing because he was one of the first that started writing. And then we'd go do these gigs. And we'd always have a huge line coming in to see us. And then that was how Vinyl Information got started.
Yeah, I mean, something I grew up listening to. Like,
wow, no
as
kidding.
A massive fusion fan. Yeah,
I think that's awesome that you know those records because they were like, they were such weird records, but in a good way. You know, like
Perfect
really,
Date,
really adventurous records. Yeah,
that tune, The Perfect Date. We're actually doing a rearrangement of it now on.
That's on Fia Fiaga, right?
I think so. Yeah, I remember Orion, Fia Fiaga.
I'm gonna cough. Hold on.
Oh, you got it.
I'm sorry. I'm just getting over.
The first record was. Called just record, Vital Information, right?
It's just called Vital Information. And that was kind of just two guitars. So that was Mike Stern and Dean Brown.
Oh, and Global Beat.
Global Beat was the third, I think.
Yeah, 87.
So there was like 83. Well, we did it 82. I think it came out in 83.
Yeah.
And then Orion. And Steve brought in Afe Albers, the guitar player from Focus.
Okay. I don't know that band.
Yeah, so Focus was a Dutch band.
Okay.
That had a hit back in the 70s. I can't remember the name of it. And so anyway, Steve was playing with them. He got a gig with them for a while, and he brought Afe in because Afe is kind of like a Holdsworth kind of a player.
Gotcha.
You know, had that kind of really fluid lyrical kind of technique, and I think Dean's still on that one.
So when did you guys, you and Steve, start really playing around Boston, like as young adults, like 17, 18 years old? What year would that have been?
Hmm. Well, I met Steve when I was still in high school. So he's like a year and a half older than me, or maybe 2 years. And he already had a license, and he borrowed his grandmother's car, and we were doing casuals, they call them in Boston, you know? And then we just started playing together, and then he got me on this rehearsal big band
at
Bridgewater State College, and that's where I met and Dave Wilczewski, the sax player. So that's, we go back to like when I was about 15.
Okay.
And so we started doing that around town and then started playing gigs with different people.
Yeah.
Just, you know.
And when would you have met Stern in Boston for the first time?
74 at Berkeley. Something? Yeah, so no, but like 75 or 6.
A little later, okay. So Bright Side's Life was already out. Pat Metheny is already sort of on
Bright Side Life was out, and Stern, I met Stern playing, Mike Stern playing with Tiger Okoshi.
Oh, and Tiger Baku?
Tiger's Baku.
Okay.
Yeah. The original Tiger's Baku was Bill Frisell.
Gotcha.
And Kermit Driscoll on bass.
Yes.
And Tommy Campbell.
Yeah. And this is Tiger Okoshi for anyone.
Yeah, Tiger, the trumpet player.
Yeah, trumpet player, yeah.
And then the next iteration had Mike replacing Bill Frisell and me replacing Kermit.
And then Dean replaced Mike, right?
And Dean replaced Mike.
Right,
eventually, yeah. And then we finally, the Tiger finally got a record deal in JVC. And we, there's two records that we did early on that are, I still think, are really good records.
But, fantastic. They're on the list, everyone. Yeah. Go check it out.
It's, there's a Mike Stern solo on there that's just unbelievable. It's so typical, Mike. But and then Vinny's on it. We got Vinny on a couple of cuts. I mean, Janek, I could tell you some stories about how we got how that happened. Vinny was on tour with Frank Zappa playing in Providence. We were recording in Rhode Island.
Whoa.
I went and picked him up after a gig.
That's right. I saw the credit was a Rhode Island studio for a Tiger Okoshi record.
Warren,
Rhode Island. Yeah. That's right. Wow.
Yeah, a great engineer, a guy named Phil Green.
Okay.
So you know, I picked up Vinny like at midnight or something, you know, brought him to the studio, you know, coffee and stuff, and we did like two or three tracks and then brought him to his hotel. At like 5 a.m.
Back on the road with
Frank. Yeah, back on the road with Frank. Wow. The next gig. Yeah. So.
That's cool. But
I wanted him on that record, you know, so bad. Because there were some tunes that he would be perfect for, and he was, you know. But anyway, so that's when I met Mike, was on the Tigers gig. And that was a lot of live stuff, playing at the clubs in the Boston area.
Yeah.
And Mike was just killing it already.
Right.
You know, he just had his thing. That
did you both get in Billy Cobham's band at the same time?
I got him. So how it worked, I played with Billy for the first time with Gil Evans' orchestra.
Gotcha.
Then I did that gig with Mike Brecker's quintet with Billy. Yep. And then he called me and said, I've got a tour in Europe I'm going to do with Don Gronick and Barry Finnerty. I want you to do it. Can you do it?
What a band.
And I was still working with Demiola.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh man, to play with Billy. And like Billy also would let you write and he'll play your tunes.
Sure.
Which Al wouldn't do that. Al was only playing his stuff.
Isn't that the trait of a lot of drummers though? I don't want to say drummers aren't musicians or can't write music, but I find they're way more open.
Yeah,
Steve
they
is
are.
The same way.
Absolutely.
And it's not like Steve is musically dumb. He's musically very advanced.
Yeah.
But he's like, no, bring your stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And Billy was just like that. And Billy writes, and Billy's one of the greatest, you know, composers out there.
Sure.
But anyway, but I like that opportunity to kind of be in more of like a feeling like a band thing. Doing Al's gig was tremendous. That's a whole other, you know, subject, and it was just an incredible thing for my career. But
sure.
But anyway, so that's how I met Billy, and so we did that European tour with Gronick and
Finnerty.
And there's a live record from that.
Ooh.
Which is called Flight Time.
Okay, I gotta check that
which
out.
Which is like, we didn't even, it was like one of these things, we're in Berlin or something, and Billy, and next thing you know, there's like, there's mics up and stuff. Oh, you're recording this? And Billy's like, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. So, yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
So, and then we came back to New York, and then, and Barry couldn't do the next thing, so I got Stern.
Okay.
And Gronick couldn't do it, so we got Gil Goldstein.
Gotcha.
And then Billy brought in Michael Urbaniak.
Yeah.
So that was the next version of that.
Like the original Iwi thing.
Yeah. And then we're playing at the Bottom Line, doing after we'd done Europe with Mike Stern, and we came back to the bottom to New York, and we're playing at the Bottom Line. Miles came to the show, and he came to see Mike.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I kind of knew that, you know. So
you guys knew that was going down?
Kinda.
Okay.
You know, so, and we're like two nights or three nights at the Bottom Line.
Yeah.
And, so in the middle of the show, there was this, the Michael Urbaniak feature, you know, Michael Urbaniak, jazz violinist and sax player and iwi player. And he's doing this unaccompanied thing and the lights, it's just a spot on him.
Yeah.
And Billy's like behind me on the stage. He's just sitting there, you know, he's got his brushes and I'm standing there and all of a sudden I hear to my left, psst, hey, bass player. It's Miles, you know? I'm like, oh, it's Miles sitting, and he's like, you know how the high stage of the Bottom Line, he's got his arms up on the stage, bass player. I come over, and he goes, tell Billy I want to talk to him. So I go to Billy, I'm trying to do this really quietly, then Vaniac's playing away, Billy, Miles wants to talk to you, you know? Billy's like, well, okay. He gets up, and he creeps over there, and I see him, I could just see them talking, you know, Billy's like crouched down, talking to Miles, and Miles grabs his brushes, you know, and they're talking and talking and talking, and then Billy's like, you know, I gotta go back, you know, and then Miles walks back to his table with Billy's brushes. So Billy comes back and he has to finish the tune with mallets or something.
Okay.
And but what it was is he says, I tell your guitar player, you know, come see me tomorrow.
Oh, wow.
So Mike went over to Miles' place over on the Upper West Side, and he got offered the gig, you know. So he came back to the gig that night, and that's how we found out.
Wow.
And then Billy needed a new guitar player because Miles basically plucked him out of the band.
So that was Dean.
Yeah, so that was, and Dean was my roommate at the time. So I said, well, you know, you should just use Dean.
And you're already in New York at this point?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and I love Dean's playing.
So this is like 80.
This was 80, exactly.
Yeah.
Well, 81.
81? That's when Mike played first time? Because I wanted to, I'm so glad you brought this up. This is an unbelievably great transition to where I wanted to go, because I wanted to know in 1980 or 81 or whenever it was that sort of a known thing? It's like, oh, that cat's going with Miles. Could you tell, like, oh, it's Bob Burp, that guy's going
with
Miles.
Because, you know, there was like this hubbub around town, like, you got to check out this guy,
right?
Stern, who's playing with Billy. He's like incredible. Yeah. And Miles just loved Stern's vibe, and he loved his sound and his time feel. So he even called him Fat Time.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, because Mike was a little heavy then. And
I was going to say, you play with Mike in the bulky years.
Oh, man. There's so many stories. I used to also play with Mike's quartet at this place called Michael's Pub in Boston. It was like an every Tuesday night thing.
Sure.
And so, you know.
I have bootlegs of that.
It was such a great gig. Yeah. And, like, you know, he'd play all his favorite standards, you know. I Love You.
I Love You.
You know,
Green Dolphin Street.
Yeah, Stella.
No Greater Love.
No Greater Love. You know him, right? So, like,
15 years I play with him. We played them all.
Falling Grace.
Yep.
You know, the Boston Standards.
Giant Steps.
And so, by the way, every week, a young Victor Bailey would come in.
Ah.
And he'd come and sit in the front, and he'd order his Coke, you know. And he'd nurse it for like three sets. And he'd always wanted to sit in, you know. Yeah. Hey, Tim, can I sit in? I'm like, yeah, you can sit in. But Mike didn't wait until the last set.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And he always would play Footprints.
Okay.
Yeah. And he'd kill it. Wow. Yeah, you know? Yeah. He was great when he was 19.
Yeah, yeah.
But that was so, you know, so that was a lot of playing with Mike before. And I hope I'm not getting too lost here. But then with Billy, you know, so Dean came in and took over for that.
Yeah.
And Dean was great for Billy. Because Dean, you know, not only just his energy and stuff, but his time feel is so strong that, you know, Billy loved that, you know, that he could do all his stuff.
And, I think Mike and Randy, too, when Dean went to play with the Brecker Brothers in that big 92 tour, was like perfect guy.
Well, Dean's rhythm playing was always one of those things that just, and Marcus, he played with Marcus for a long time.
Right,
yeah. So, but there's a one funny incident where when Dean first got into Billy's band, you know, Billy would sometimes do these long drum fills, like two bars, you know, with like ridiculous, like,
you hear the train coming way off.
and then I would always be able to hit the downbeat with Billy. And Dean, who hasn't had amazing time, you know, at one point after a gig, he says, Tim, he said, man, I got to ask you, how the hell do you know where the downbeat is in some of those fills, man? I can't figure it out. And I said, if Billy hits the China boy above the hi-hat, that's the end of four. If he hits the crash cymbal over there, that's one.
Oh, that's great.
You know, they're like, huh.
Okay. There's a playbook here. There's a roadmap.
I mean, kind of, you know, but it was kind of true. Sure. I did it to be funny, but it was kind of true. Yeah, you know, sometimes, you know, you kind of have to watch this.
Yeah.
You know, as a bass player, you'd have to learn things about the drummers you play
with. Of course, all the nuances.
And sticking sometimes are your friends.
Yes.
Yeah, because, you know, you can get lost. I'm playing with Vinnie, for instance, over the years, and Steve, and like people with those kinds of chops and the ability to like, you know, superimpose and over the bar line and all that stuff. You know, those kinds of weird groupings and stuff. It's so easy to get lost unless you're like,
You know, stomping,
banging
out,
away. Yeah. So once you kind of learn their stickings, you know, or little phrases they do, you know, that can like bring you back.
Sure.
You know, like you can get lost for a second. Oh, okay, yeah. He always leads with his right on that one, so I know that's like that's at least a quarter note, you know, downbeat. You know.
Yeah. I want to jump ahead to 2002, because we share another mutual. Like I never did like his gig, but we were at school together, Damian Dragici.
No way.
Yeah. So we played a lot. We played a bunch of gigs.
Oh, that's
like,
amazing.
I never did his whole epic thing like you did, that there's the movie.
What an amazing musician he is.
Insane, right?
Yeah.
Like, he'd be there in the Hal Crook ensemble playing, you know, Countdown on a pan flute. He's this Romanian kind of... I don't want to use gypsy.
He's like a savant.
But like a gypsy musician, that style of folk... like Romanian folk playing, and he happens to be a pan flute player.
With a heavy classical, you know.
Yeah. Can read anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's one of these people, like, wow.
That was you and Joel Taylor?
Taylor, yeah. That was, Do you know who Brian Hughes is, a Canadian guitar player?
Yeah.
I was playing with Brian, and Brian got called to do that gig.
Yeah.
And he recommended me for it. Oh, wait a second. Yeah, he was on. No, that's not true. He was on it. Vinnie recommended it. Vinnie was supposed to be on that project.
Okay.
Colaiuta. And he ended up bowing out at the last minute.
Okay.
But I stayed on. And they had another drummer come in from one rehearsal, and he couldn't really play Odd Times. He was a bad fit.
Okay.
I can't remember who it was. And then, so I suggested Joel.
Yeah.
And Joel
sounds great.
Killed it.
Yeah.
So, you know, it was what it was. It was a trip to Romania to do this PBS special.
Sure.
You know, live in front of the palace.
Yeah, it was insane. And
a big production with a full, the Bucharest Orchestra. Oh, yeah. It was insane, man.
Absolutely.
It was insane. Yeah. But it was fun. It was super fun.
How long did the production last for that? Like,
was like 10 days.
Okay, for one show.
Was like, well, getting over there,
right,
rehearsing with the orchestra, then rehearsing with the small group stuff.
Yeah.
And we had rehearsed in L.A. for a few couple, gotcha, maybe about 3-4 days.
Damon was still living out here?
Yeah, then? He was here, and we rehearsed here first, and then went over there and rehearsed with the orchestra, then did like 2 days of shooting.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, shot for 2 days. So there were two concerts.
Think, yeah, something like that, and they edited it together. Maybe I might be wrong, but I hope I'm not. But whatever it was a big.
I mean, you guys can watch it. It's on YouTube.
It was a big ordeal, and like I'm playing this weird like the bass company bass, which was like, not, it doesn't exist anymore.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, I had fun doing that gig.
Yeah,
it was just.
So, and what is that? There's another thing that you did with Johnny Halliday.
Oh yeah.
There's one cut on there. It's like a thing with Landau.
Yeah.
And I want to say Vinnie as well, maybe. Or not.
Okay.
Or someone else. I'm not sure. I know it was Landau. It's just, it's one cut, and the whole of the rest of the record is a European band.
Yeah, it was a Scotty Brothers thing.
Okay.
Scotty Brothers was this, they had a studio in Santa Monica, and they also had a record company, and they had bands like Survivor.
Okay.
And stuff like that. And they're also known for their... they were in the distribution business.
Okay.
Music, you know,
okay.
Records. And like, you know, and like getting your songs played on the radio,
sure,
kind of thing.
Sure,
I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah.
And they, you know, so they were kind of famous. So there's stuff about them in books.
Okay.
So they had a studio, and they had a producer named Richie Wise who did a lot of records.
Yeah.
And I played on Johnny Halliday's son's record, David Halliday.
Okay.
And then Johnny wanted to do this one tune, so they just hired us for the day.
Yeah, it was just crazy to, I don't know how much of that you've done in terms of it being like a small portion of a larger European or foreign project.
Yeah.
But like Landau comes in, it's like, oh, this is night and day.
Yeah.
This is what you're paying for.
Oh, yeah.
Like you hear the sound of the bass and it's like, oh, this is for real, for real.
The LA thing was just, you know, it was,
it's
they had it figured out back then, you know. And Landau, man, that guy, I love playing with him. I didn't play with him often enough. I would love to play more with him, but he always amazed me because he didn't come across as a person that was as intellectually musical as he is.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because he's just such a laid back guy and he's so funny.
Yeah.
That you think he's just kind of like this rocker dude, you know, and then, but no, man, he's like,
really,
he's
serious.
Deep. He's really deep.
I think one of the best live shows I've ever seen was James Taylor at the Hollywood Bowl.
Oh man,
and the Hollywood Bowl sounds like garbage as soon as you put a drum set and electric bass in it normally. And it sounded like I was listening to the record.
No kidding.
And I think that's a testament to the front of house, but also, you know, to Landau and Jimmy and Gad.
Was that Jimmy?
It was Jimmy and Gad.
Yeah, that's
and it was Larry
band.
Goldings. It was like the A band with Walt Fowler and Lou Marini. It was like the AAA band.
Yeah, that's like the gig, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if Jimmy ever wants to not do that gig, like he would.
Yeah.
You know, that's one of them.
I got to sit and see Jimmy and Lee talking to each other because it was basically handed off from Lee to Jimmy.
Yeah.
And just there, they just seem like very... very happy that they'd both done it and just very wise. And,
yeah, I mean, doesn't it kind of figure?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, you get to play the great music, listening to his, you know, incredibly golden voice, you know, and he's just a nice guy and like, I'm sure he pays well. I don't know.
Oh, I've heard, imagine. Rumor has it that it is spectacular.
You know, let's just say he does.
He's also the guy who keeps like at least 15 people more on the road than he needs to because he wants to give people work. And he's like, he seems like a really nice...
He's a legendary cool guy. Like, I mean, even like back when I was working with Don Grolnick back in the, you know, 1980 with Billy and stuff, he was doing James Taylor's gig then.
With Carlos Vega, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like, yeah, that was the gig.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you ever get, was there ever that thing of like, the artist comes in, you're on one of these 5-day long record dates, and the artist like, well, can we take these guys on the road? Because they're like, because you guys are killing. Did that come up? Were you offered tours on the back?
Yeah, every once in a while, like Tracy Chapman was like that, Tori Amos a little bit.
Okay. Did you do any of them?
Definitely Farron.
Okay.
You know, we did that record, but she wasn't that, she didn't have a, you know, she was huge in Canada, not so much in the States. They were trying to break her here.
Yeah.
I didn't end up doing that, no. Okay. But
did you play with Tracy live?
I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Talk to me about that, because I want to say that Crossroads, right, was the album. Crossroads came out, I think, only a year after, I only know Fast Car, sadly, from that first record. I don't know what the name of the record was, the debut record. When you're
I can't remember either.
When you're in the studio doing Crossroads, is there holy shit, has been one of the biggest hits of the year? We have to make something spectacular as a follow-up record.
It's in the back of your mind. When an artist is that huge.
So she was that huge by the time you were cutting the second record.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just wondered how long it had taken for that song to explode.
And it was the second record was one of those it's a good record, but it wasn't going to be as big as the first one.
Right.
You know, it just was impossible.
I listened to the whole thing. I think you're playing on a couple of tracks.
I'm on two.
One is
two,
upright, I think. Yeah.
But, you know, it was like, you can't help it, but when you work with an artist with that kind of, you know, success that, you know, this, whatever it is, it's going to be heard, you know.
Right.
So, and you want to try to do something that's worthy of that.
Sure.
You know? So, yeah, it's a little pressure there.
Just wonder, everyone, like, oh, shit, you know.
Yeah, I mean, that one of those record dates was kind of funny in the sense that, like, she had a little dog, I can't remember if it was a dachshund or something, but that she had with her all the time. Uh-huh. And I came in to do an overdub on this one, too, and an upright. Mm-hmm. And so I walked in the studio, and they said, yeah, Tim, we're going to put you in the vocal booth and record upright there. I said, cool. Oh. So I brought my upright in, and there's like a little doggy bed there and like a little water, you know, bowl.
In the booth?
In the booth, yeah. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. And then the dog's in there. And so, you know, they start playing the tune for me and I'm like writing out a chart and I'm going, hey, you know, there's a dog in here. Because I mean, there's two mics on the bass, right? There's a condenser mic and a tube mic. And they can hear me, like, you can hear the nose hairs when I'm breathing, right? I'm like, hey, there's a dog in here, right? You know that, right? And they're like, yeah. It's like, okay, so I'm starting to run it down, and I said, okay, well, let's take one. I'm like, you know, there's a dog in here. so they come out and say, listen, the dog is, like, not going anywhere. If it makes a noise or something, we'll just retake it. So obviously the dog took precedence over me. So like,
do you get the sense like she had become that much of a star by then?
I don't know if she's just a dog lover, you know. Yeah, but okay. I didn't really get to know her too well then because I just did that session. When I toured with her a little bit later, I got to know her. She's really sweet, really good, you know. Very shy person, actually,
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Interesting.
You know, I mean, you know, just very much about her music and not about being, you know, in the limelight at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, really easy to work with.
Now, I read... I'm scanning credits like crazy the last 2 weeks or last week or whatever since we connected on the phone. Am I right in saying that you did a bunch of work on the production, maybe even the writing side of stuff like John Tesh and those kind of albums?
Yeah.
Which to me is like such a different lane.
Oh, completely.
And some of those sound like they have full orchestra and like not simple production.
I have to talk a little bit about Tesh because when I first started doing Tesh's gig, you know, he was the talking head on Entertainment Tonight, you know.
Okay.
He was the guy that, you know, with Mary Hart that was like, you know, and it's a celebrity birthday today or, you know, something like that.
No way, I didn't know this. Okay.
And, you know, and he was always a musician, but this was his gig.
Main
gig. TV personality.
Wow, okay.
So when I met him doing this late night TV show, the Pat Sajak show. He came on the show, and he came up to Tom Scott afterwards and said, "Hey, Tim, your bass player? Does he plays fretless bass?" And Tom says, "Yeah." He said, "I want to use him on a record." He had written a song for Toots Thielman, and it's on one of his records. And so
I saw Toots credited on there.
So he asked me if I would play. So I went to John's studio and overdubbed the part, and John loved it, and he loved me, and he was like so cool, and he sent me this thank you card, and like he was just really super nice, and he kept asking me, you know, to play on his stuff. And then next thing you know, he's like, hey, you know, I've got this I'm doing like the Today Show, you know. I need you guys to come out and play, you know, one song.
Yeah.
And he'd fly us out and stay at the best hotel, you know, get up at 4 a.m.
Out in New York.
Yeah. That, go do one.
That call is the
worst. Yeah, it's so early, right?
4 a.m.
Then you go do one song and then go get coffee or something, you know. And like, and he was the greatest guy. And so when I started doing it and word got around town that I'm doing Tesh's gig, you know, it was a little bit kind of an auspicious gig, you know. And like, I walk into a date and I go, oh, so you're doing that, how's that Tesh thing, man? And I remember, like, I forgot which trumpet player it was. It's somebody like Gary Grant or Jerry Hay or something. Like, I walk into the date and like they go, you know, they're playing the Tonight, the Entertainment Tonight. And like, I'm like, yeah, you know.
Wow.
And so,
that's brutal.
And so, you know, and so then about a year or so later, when John was doing like the NBA theme or something, you know, this guy's going, hey, Tim, does John need a trumpet player on this thing?
Yeah, right.
You know, so it turned into a really good, what I'm saying is like, it started out as being, okay, well, he's like this personality guy, but he's actually a really good musician and he's really fun to work with and he gets you involved. And so I loved working with him. And he paid really fairly and, you know, and it became a really good account.
And it's kind of a priceless element to me when somebody is that interested in you as a musician to have you involved in the process.
Absolutely.
You know,
and he trusted me so much that he actually got me, I did some of my best and biggest productions with him.
Okay.
You know, I produced big band records, I produced worship records with him, big like PBS specials, really great credits and really great experiences. And you know,
did you do much stuff where you didn't play but did produce,
or were you only a couple on like because there were a couple of his orchestra records where I was just in the booth, but even on the big band record, for instance, I would go in and play, like just do one take, you know, because we had the band playing live and it was a really good band, and everybody, this was like at East West, and so I would be in the vocal booth next to the console and just play one take on upright, then come in and figure I'll just redo my bass later, you know, so because I had to produce the record, you know. So then but it turned out that we ended up keeping pretty much everything.
Nice.
but that was the best I could do to kind of try to separate myself from like the session thing to being in a producer's chair. It's when you're that big of a ensemble, you're better off not playing.
Yeah.
Because it's hard to like really pay attention.
That's why I asked. I've only done it a couple of times with, you know, only once with a full orchestra, but sometimes with like a 28-piece section and just, it's too much.
Oh, so you know,
this is too much.
You have to really pay attention.
And you can't be like trusting someone else to co-produce. Hey, can you make sure you pick out all the mistakes and the edits? Like, you have to be making notes. Like,
there's one session I did where I wasn't paying enough attention and the kick drum mic was distorting.
Oh.
And didn't hear it, you know. And what can you do about that? You just have to go back and recut it.
Yeah.
That was on me.
That's also the worst feeling as a player as well, when you get through something and you realize somebody's made a massive boo-boo.
Yeah.
Technically speaking.
And when it's you, it's like,
got to be kidding. When it's you, sure, but I'm just thinking as a sideman.
Oh, yeah,
And you walk in the control room and you're like, are you listening to this?
Yeah, I see. Yeah,
You know.
Yeah.
I'm guessing the types of sessions you were on, that is a very rare occurrence.
No, it happens.
But you know, it does happen, right?
I mean, the thing that used to happen a lot, it doesn't happen so much now because we don't do those kind of dates as much as we used to, but when the headphone thing would go crazy, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Would there be a feedback loop? And then you'd see like, you know, 12 sets of headphones go flying across the room. I remember one time, Vinnie, he throws his headphones off, he goes, "Career killer!"
Wow.
Yeah.
Brutal.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That is brutal.
He's got a wit on him. And I miss Vinnie, man.
Yeah.
I don't see him enough. But anyway.
When you look back on doing stuff with, there are a couple of records, Thunder from Down Under.
Oh, man. I love doing Frank Gambale records.
So there are a couple of Frank records that I
love
was checking
doing those.
Out. Again, a record with a ton of people on them.
Yeah.
There's one record that Chick is credited on the whole thing as the Rhodes player. Is that an accurate credit?
Yeah.
He just played on the whole thing?
Yeah, and some of it is just like when Frank's laying out, it's just trio.
Right.
You know, with
with
me
you.
And, I think Joey Heredia is on one.
Heredia, like, yeah, exactly. Like, I saw Joey.
Some kind of samba, a Latin thing. And
yes.
Chick's just taking this extended solo.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just going, man, this is awesome.
Yeah.
You know?
Was that at Mad Hatter back in the Chick studio? Or
I think, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, because Chick was on his, you know.
So thing. Where is that, where's the line? Where's that thing of like, you're doing John Tesh records, okay, but you have a little closer relationship with him eventually, so
yeah.
There's maybe an understanding there, but where's that line of like, you just played on a Frank Gambale date with Chick Corea and Joey Heredia, and then you're going in to play like, what was the record, the Al Stewart thing, or, oh, there were so many big band records. Are you just like...
Yeah. Yeah,
you
yeah.
Don't
you
talk about
put on a different hat.
Yeah,
you know, absolutely.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. It was funny. Alan Pask was the one that told me when I was on this big record rock date that I think it was the same one that was the Soundcastle with I told you about the drum sounds and we got paid for 2 days.
Oh yeah, like Eddie Money Day or something. What was it?
It was that was Robert Tepper.
Oh, okay,
Robert Tepper, which ended up being on the Rocky IV soundtrack,
oh, okay.
No Easy Way Out tune.
Oh. Yeah,
it starts out with a bass with a pick bass.
Yeah.
So, which by the way is it's my old like early 70s maple P bass through an SVT and nice. Like just slammed with compression.
Wow.
Like there's no low end on it. Just like, yeah, it's super, super picky. But yeah, I mean, Alec Pasqua says to me, because he knew me from Boston.
Yeah.
He said, listen, don't tell anybody about your, you know, about your Demiola stuff and like the Billy Cobham stuff. Because when I was doing rock dates, like back then, there were two different kinds of musicians,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
There were the guys that did all the rock dates and did all the pop dates. And then there were guys that did the jazz stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and like those two didn't mix.
Because you and Steve, I didn't realize you and Steve both did rock dates, and Steve doing the huge
yeah.
rock date,
yeah.
shall we say.
And you got the Journey gig.
The one big one. But you guys are both on one of those Gambale records together
yeah.
on a couple that's of right. tracks.
That's a good one, yeah.
It's a great one.
Yeah.
So, and the sound.
I miss playing with Steve too, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's been a long time.
Oh, man.
Because we cut our teeth together, really.
There's but, an insanely great video of you guys, 91, at the NAMM show, I believe.
Oh, the one with Jan Hammer. Hammer? Oh, man. Did he kill that or what?
It's ridiculous.
Oh, I mean, man. It's insane. It's on fire.
Steve is out of his mind.
Yeah.
He's playing unconscious.
Well, Herbie Hancock was in the audience.
Sitting in the front row.
Yeah.
I got to the end of the video. I was like, it's Herbie.
I know Steve was... And Steve's amazing anyway,
oh, yeah,
but you know, but he just... poured it on, man.
Oh, and then yeah. Jan and Tom going and Gambale trading.
And they're all trying to outdo each
yeah,
other,
yeah, yeah.
man. And I'm just like, just shuffling it away. I mean, it was fun, you know.
Super
it was fun.
Fun.
But yeah, that's funny you saw that. That's like,
really great video.
But yeah, so Pasqua said, you know, he just said, you got to, you know, just don't broadcast that
right.
so much, you know, because they, you know, these musicians that don't understand that, some of them will just instantly get intimidated thinking that, you know, well, you know, I can't hang with you
right.
musically.
Right.
I don't understand you, you know, or they could be intimidated by you. You might, you know, oh, he's, you know.
What's interesting to me now is there's no way, I mean, that scene doesn't exist anymore. But if it did in such an intense, voluminous capacity, there's no way to separate the two. Because everyone knows everything about
exactly.
everyone. They know what
yeah.
you had avocado toast for breakfast and how
yeah.
you like your martini.
Exactly. Like, our generation, like my generation, yeah. I'm in my mid-60s now.
Right.
It's like you get like, I grew up playing rock and roll music and listening
sure.
to pop. You know, the radio when I was a kid would be everything from like the Supremes to like, you know, all the Motown stuff
right.
and like Hendrix and Frank Sinatra and like instrumental weird like novelty tunes. It was everything
yes.
on yeah, the radio yeah, yeah. on the same radio station.
Sure.
It wasn't like urban stations and pop stations and AOR stations.
Yeah.
And it was just everything was on WRKO
right.
and that was it.
Yeah.
And so you learned and listened to everything and wanted to play everything and, you know, and then the funk thing and the R&B thing. And as a bass player, you know, I mean, I started on guitar when I was really young.
Sure.
I switched to bass when I was like 13 or 14 and started playing in my high school big band. And that's how I got hooked on bass. And
right.
I was it. I was sold. But so I think there was an authenticity to like having that kind of mixed background
sure.
and really being able to play all that stuff for real, not
yeah.
just posing.
Right.
And like, and then having some sort of jazz, you know, education.
Yeah.
to use that. I mean, it took me a while to kind of really get into playing jazz and trying to be good at it. I wasn't very good at first. I mean, like, I tried, you know, but it took me a while to mature, you know, and to, like, especially improvising and stuff. You know, I'm still striving,
and
you know.
What about that thing, that visual reference, that which is so readily available now? Not only can you get, like, hey, you want to learn one of Tim Lana's tunes? You've got Tim on. You might have you on YouTube saying, "Here's," and you might have 50 other guys also giving a lesson on that same thing.
Yeah,
with 19 different.
Oh yeah, there's all these people that play your parts.
Right.
On you know doing covers.
Yeah,
of the stuff that you play on,
breaking it down,
and they do it better than you did. Which is kind of, which is weird, with a better sound. But yeah, you're right. I mean, everything's out there.
You know, my buddy, I always reference this anecdote. My buddy Steve Wolf is an amazing studio drummer. Lives out here now.
Yeah,
and he
yeah.
said, you know. The first time I went to see Billy Cobham live, I'd only ever heard him on record. I'd never seen a single thing, and I learned all these things.
Yeah.
I saw him live, and I was like, all the stickings were wrong.
Yeah.
You know?
Especially when it comes to Billy. Yeah.
Right.
But yeah.
That thing of like, there was this built-in necessity to figure it out.
Right.
And now it's just like, no, here it is.
Yeah.
Everything's right here for you.
Yeah.
I wonder how that is affecting the way we move forward mm-hmm. as musicians now as much.
That's interesting. And coming from you too, with as much material as you offer, you know, and like, because I have a lot of students, you know, I teach part-time at LA College of Music, and which I love. I love having students and like, you know, just trying to share whatever I have.
Right.
But you'd be surprised how many of them use your material and they bring it to me.
Well,
and I'm like, I don't know what he's talking
but
about.
But I'm kind of the YouTube asshole in that sense, because I don't spoon feed it.
Yeah.
I don't say, oh, this here and that. I don't break it down into the tiniest little micro view. I say, hey, stop listening with your eyes.
Yeah.
Listen with your ears.
Yeah.
You know, I bridge that gap of analog to digital. I'm born in 78. So
yeah.
I'm in that generation.
There is something to be said about some of the YouTube musicians that are quite good, but don't have ensemble experience.
Sure.
You know, that's one thing I noticed right away.
Technical prowess is probably through the roof.
Through the roof, but then they get
experience.
No idea how to play with others.
Right.
Which is a very strange thing.
Very strange. Yeah.
You know, and it's a strange phenomenon that happened born out of YouTube.
Right. Because I don't know if your memory is anything like mine, but my first memories of playing music was always with other people.
Yeah.
Very seldom was it like, do I remember, oh yeah, that day I sat in my bedroom and
practiced. I mean, you know, we practiced with records.
Sure.
You know, and like, you know, tried to learn the solo to, you know, Black Magic Woman or something, you know, whatever.
But the moments that mattered to me anyway were with other people.
Okay, so the shed and my mother's basement stuff with Steve.
With Steve, yeah.
We would get together, Steve and I, mm-hmm. after school.
Yeah.
He went to Whitman High School, I went to Brockton High School.
Gotcha.
These two towns close to each other.
In Massachusetts. Yeah.
Massachusetts. And, you know, like I said, Steve had a car, you know.
Yeah.
So we'd get together, he wanted to come to my house and shed and play, you know, we'd just jam. Just bass and drums.
Yeah.
You know,
nice.
And we go over to the shed. So the shed he had in his backyard. Do you know about this shed? His dad's shed.
No.
So in the backyard of the Smith, you know, house, was his dad's shed, which he had his tools in. And his dad was a hunter, and he also had he made his own bullet. He has casings and stuff.
Gotcha.
So everything was in there. And Steve's drum set, which then was like a Rogers kit, like a single bass drum kit with like, you know, like pretty much a Buddy Rich kit.
Yeah.
But Rogers, not Slingerland. Yeah, he was really into Buddy back then.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he even had his Gride Simple down here.
Yeah.
But anyway, I bring over my little EMC, you know, amp. It was the smallest amp I had. My Rickenbacker. And we just...
Go for it.
We just flail.
Yeah.
You know, and then take a break, you know.
Yeah.
And then we'd go to my mom's house, and then he'd bring his kid over... Or I had a kid. No, he'd bring his kid over, and we'd like watch the Three Stooges, and then during the commercial breaks, we'd like just play really fast.
Yeah,
and then we'll go back to the show. Yeah. Oh, yeah. But what we were trying to like, you know, Steve would like be into this record. Oh man, go check out this Headhunters record. Check this out, man. This is the most amazing. You know, he can get really, really into it. You know, he's like, man, you got to check this out.
Yeah.
He'd slap the side on and, you know, play this thing, and he'd play this one fill over and over and over again.
Yeah.
You know, and then we'd go, and we'd try to play that, you know. So that's kind of how we got, you know, especially with Steve, we just played together all the time. I mean, I had my bandmates from my, you know, elementary school and junior high and stuff, but when I met Steve, it was a different kind of intensity. I met for the first time a person who had the most drive I'd ever seen.
Like heading towards professionalism already.
He practiced more than anyone I'd ever met. You know, he really did.
Yeah, yeah.
He put a lot. I mean, you can't play like him and not put the time into it.
Every night before the gig is the process he goes through, and I'm like, damn,
that was
dude.
The thing about him and Vinnie Colaiuta too. Yeah. Vinnie was another one who put a lot of time in,
sure.
you know,
yeah.
and practiced his butt off all his entire young life and still, and you know. And so when I met that, Steve, it also pushed me to be much, much better.
Sure.
You know, and it's like, he said, you know, he had introduced me to Steubenhaus, Neal Steubenhaus, and who I admired. He said, I was complaining to Steve that I didn't have an instructor, a bass instructor.
Okay.
And he said, you know, you should call my friend Neal. I'm going to school with him, and he's given lessons. Okay, fine. So I called Neal. I said, my name's Tim. I'm a friend of Steve's. You know, oh, yeah, yeah. He said, well, come up to my place, you know, bring your bass and play for me, and let's see where you are, you know.
Bring the Rickenbacker?
So I brought the Rickenbacker, and I just bought a fretless Precision. I was playing with my high school big band. Oh, not good. So I played for him, and he goes, okay, man. He goes, well, first of all, you're not ready for that.
Whoa.
Pointing to the fretless. And then he looked at the Rickenbacker and goes, you got to get a real bass.
Wow.
And I'm like, oh, man. Brutal. I was like, okay.
Fender.
But, you know, he was right.
Yeah.
You know, get a jazz bass, go find. So I went, on the classifieds and found an old 63 jazz bass. It was refinished for like $200.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Oh. But that was, you know, the right thing. And his point being, you know, you got to play a bass that you can use in any situation.
Sure.
Rickenbacker is a great bass for like one thing.
Right.
It's got that sound.
Yeah, sure.
Which is a great sound. And I was a big Chris Squire fan. That's why I had it. You know, my first bass playing days were with the high school big band and with like a couple of local bands, one like a Chicago kind of band and a Zeppelin band.
Okay.
And we did the first three records back to back.
Big rock sound.
Yeah, yeah. So I had an EB3 and a 360.
Yeah.
Acoustic 360. That was
amazing.
My rig. Yeah.
God.
Yeah.
Well, I wouldn't give for one of those now.
That was a great rig, man.
Yeah.
It really was. It was the only thing that could cut through with it. The guitar player had like a 200-watt Marshall.
Yeah.
And something about the acoustic 360 cabinet, because of that reverse-mounted 18, it like by the time the sound wave came out, it could cut through that Marshall.
I haven't done that much like super mega loud rock stuff in my life, but the one time I played with Eric Johnson in the studio, and he had his four... 412s.
You play with Eric Johnson
at one
that
time
in the
studio, whatever.
Wow.
And Fender, I was with Fender amps at the time. This is like 20 years ago or something. And they sent me the biggest thing they had. I couldn't hear a thing.
Yeah.
Couldn't hear a thing.
That's frustrating.
So he had two Echoplexes, real ones,
nice.
In his pedal board.
Nice. I had a Bassman 100 when I was in high school. And that was a weird... It came with four 12s, I think.
Okay.
That were mounted like this.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
They were all canceling each other out as far as I could tell.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know. But it was 100 watts, though.
Okay. 100
tube watts, and it still wasn't loud enough.
Okay.
Yeah.
This could be another 3 hours.
I know.
I got so many things I would love to talk to you about. No, please don't apologize. One thing I will propose is that maybe when we come to LA with Vital Information, we do a little bit of a hang with Steve here at the house, maybe record it.
Oh, talk that'll
a little
be hilarious.
Bit, which would be really fun.
Yeah, it'd be great to see him too.
We're playing the first week of May at the Baked Potato for three
awesome.
Nights, which would be super fun. Hopefully you can come down.
I'm going to
see
be there.
The gig. I got one more thing that I would love to know about before we get out of here and call it quits on this episode. 1987, the GRP live in concert in Japan with, that is like the super band project, right? Just the suit with Chikorita Electric Band.
Yeah.
Diana Shore.
Yeah.
Just everyone and everyone.
Tom Scott,
right?
Of course, Patitucci and
so
Eric.
I was gonna say,
and the whole electric
two
band.
Bass players on the night are you and John.
Yeah,
basically. How is that? Because that was to me the heyday of the 80s, the Japanese bonus tracks on records.
Right, right.
Which I think now this reminded me another thing. You did a Japanese bonus track on a Vince Neil record.
Yeah,
is that right? The Iggy Pop cover.
Yeah. I did a whole Vince Neil record.
Oh, you did a whole Vince Neil record as well.
Yeah,
I just saw the pop car. I got to say, I will add everything I've missed today. I will add it to that playlist.
I'm sure there's good stories to all of them, but anyway.
Right, but I'm just saying that whole
one.
Thing about Japan and LA, or just Japan and the States in the 80s, seemed like a magical time.
Yeah.
What was it like being in the center of that on arguably one of the biggest moments in that entire history?
Yeah, you know, that project was... it was kind of epic. You felt that way when it was happening because, right. I mean, it was all being videotaped.
To me, that's great.
You know,
that it
recorded
wasn't just another gig
digitally. You know, right. I mean, it was a whole, you know, audio file.
Yes.
Video was going to be on Laserdisc, you know.
The video, you can watch this, folks. You can watch this on yeah. YouTube. Go search for that concert. It opens up with Laserdisc.
Yeah.
That's the opening.
Yeah, I mean,
credit.
So you know, it was a production, and they treated us so great. You know, yeah. It was just a big ordeal. And those guys, the GRP, you know, that so. Dave Grusin, of course, who yep. was a, you know, the partner with Rosen,
yes,
you know, for GRP,
yep.
and Lee,
yep.
who was their biggest artist, and Tom Scott, and Diane Shore, and Chick, who was their other biggest artist.
Right,
that was just a big thing, and like, and then so the side guys really were Vinnie,
yeah.
and myself, and Barnaby cool. Finch, and. And that, but the electric
Wekalone
band
played with the electric band.
It was the electric band,
gotcha.
So they were their own entity, you know.
Gotcha.
And so we were kind of like side guys on it, really. Yeah. But I was really happy to be there.
Yeah.
We weren't featured at all, you know. But that's cool.
Yeah,
know? It was great. It was just great to be there. But we did have to play. I remember with Diane Shore, like at the beginning, we didn't even know we were going to do that until
oh, wow.
we were there, you know. And she had okay. all these tunes, and it was fun, you know.
Yeah.
But what was really funny about it was seeing like Weckl and Vinny both kind of like having this. Kind of like they were aware of each other.
Okay,
I'll just say that, and you can hear it in the playing.
Yeah, of course, of
you
course.
Know,
yeah.
There's a little bit of overplaying going on there.
So there was some light competition happening.
A little bit, but it's so. But the funny thing is, and all the people that I know that I've met over the years, especially drummers that have seen that, like that's one of their favorite things
right.
ever.
Oh.
Because Vinny's just over the top, and so is Weckl. They're
yeah.
just playing their butts off, you
yeah.
know.
To me, those moments are huge. Like the Live Under the Sky, the festival that used to happen in Japan.
Oh,
just
yeah.
amazing moments the
yeah.
Japanese promoters would put together.
Yeah.
That also would rarely sort of happen here or anywhere else, actually.
Yeah.
Maybe Japan was the only place with the budget or...
I did that, I think, once in 83 with the Crusaders.
Okay.
Which, would, by the way, was with Larry Graham.
Wow.
I got to play with Larry Graham.
Wow.
Which was really interesting.
That is cool.
Yeah.
And who was in the Crusader? Who was singing lead then?
Well, Larry did.
Oh, okay.
So that's why he was on it. So he would sing the, you know, Streetlights and all that. But
yeah,
he
yeah.
also Street Life. But he also did his own thing, One in a Million You, and like
okay.
something else. And but it was Joe Sample and Wilton, and Styx Hooper wasn't on it. It was Ndugu.
Why am I blanking on the name of the female singer who sang Street Life?
Randy Crawford.
Randy Crawford.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Barry Finity was on it.
No kidding.
And oh God, it was a big band. Really famous studio guitar player was the other guitar player on it. I'm sorry, his name's escaping me at the moment.
All good.
And Dom Romeo was on percussion.
Yeah.
And so it was really fun. That was
yeah.
in 83 or something. But that, I'd never done the Live Under the Sky before. That's a huge, huge festival.
Insane.
I mean,
yeah.
gigantic thing.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I know we can do this forever.
And I really want to, and I would love to have you back again. It's awesome.
I am honored to do this, honestly. I'm like, this is so cool.
It is my great pleasure to finally meet you after all these years
me
of
too.
Listening to you and to be the coolest thing to me is to be playing in the same band that you did with Steve.
Yeah, we got to talk about
years.
That on our own.
Absolutely, yeah. There's plenty of that.
Yeah.
You're the man. I really appreciate it, man. Thank
My
you.
My pleasure.
That's it.
Nice
guys,
to meet you.
Girls, everyone listening, go check out everything Tim has ever done. Most of it's in that playlist on Spotify. And yeah, we'll see you.
Bye. Thank you.